Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Thank you for inviting me, and thank you all for coming on a Saturday morning, a very cold Saturday morning, but I appreciate it. So maybe I can give you a very quick brief introduction to myself and my background, and then we can look at an introduction to Chinaccelerator, and then we can, you know, have question and answers from there. So my name is Manmeet. I am an Indian citizen, but I grew up in about 10 different countries. So every 3 odd years, we would move to a new country. So I, you know, for me, the question of where is home is basically where the family is. And right now, my family lives in Japan. So in terms of sort of my education and so on, I have bachelor's of arts and bachelor's science degrees from Washington Lee University in Virginia, where I majored in economics, French, and engineering. Then I did an MBA in India from an institute called SPJAN. And then I joined India's largest private sector bank. And my very first exposure to corporate life or business life, so to speak, was in banking, institutional banking. And our responsibility or the team that I was a part of, a very small team, and we were tasked with taking the bank global. So that was literally my first serious career project, was to help as the junior most member of the team, the one with the, you know, least experience, but working in a very, very high caliber team to take the bank global. And that's how it all started off. So for me, in fact, my career has been entrepreneurial from day one, because that itself was sort of an entrepreneurial venture or whatever you have. There's a very small core team. We had the resources of the bank, almost limitless resources. So that's the good part. But we literally had to define a market, define a business proposition, you know, build business models, identify where the bank should go, what it should do, what it should not do. And then the team was built around what's required and so on and so forth. And then we built, and then we started, you know, opening offices in different countries, and then teams were sent to run those offices over time. Yeah.
What was the name of the bank?
It's called ICICI Bank. Yeah, so it's the largest private sector bank in India. And so that was starting in 2001 after I graduated from my MBA. And 2003, I moved to China. Until then, I was handling the bank's relationships, institutional relationships in Asia Pacific. Then I moved to China in 2003 as part of the team that started the entire operations of the bank for North Asia, based out of Shanghai. Stayed with the bank for 2 years. And in 2005, I left a corporate job and I started my own financial advisory firm. So this was sort of my first actual entrepreneurial venture. And I was only 4 years out of my MBA program. I mean, the main reason I think that I went entrepreneurial was that at that time, so we're talking about 2004, 2005 in China. Yeah, at that time, if you looked at the market in China, you looked at the economic growth, you looked at the opportunities, it was just insane growth on every metric, every market, every possible business that you can think of. The growth was all sort of exponential if you look at it. So I thought to myself that if I don't do something entrepreneurial now, at this stage of my life, in China, then I will never do something entrepreneurial. So I just jumped, literally jumped. And the day I finished working in my bank was the first day I started on my own business. The idea for that consulting company was something, you know, looking at India, China, investment flows. But it turned out, like any startup, that wasn't really a great idea. You know, both my own experience or understanding of it, the timing from a market perspective, many things were not right. So over time then, you know, the business pivoted to actually providing advisory work to Chinese companies. and medium-sized companies that were having tremendous growth, but they were then stuck with a lot of, you know, financial issues and so on. So then advising them, helping them to grow in some industries or maybe not get so involved in other industries that they're diversified into and so on. So we built this company, and then by 2012, we had a buyer for the company and we had a decent exit. In the meantime, if any of you have any understanding or experience with China, once you have such a high growth market, opportunities are everywhere. And you get greedy. You want to take part of so many opportunities. So sometimes, you know, some of my clients would have some opportunities and we would help them and advise them. And then they would get into some new business and they say, you know what, you advise this business. Yes, I advise this business. So yeah, why don't you come and also run it? Or why don't you guys build it for us and, you know, we can have some partnership model. So we got into some of these kind of ventures as well. Like any startup experience, most were failures. At the end of the day, they didn't work for various reasons, and so it shifted. But we had a few that were, you know, really, really successful. For example, we had one, since most of you are from an IT sort of background, so we had this one where we were training kids from universities in China on IT skills. You know, globally, in any market I think that you would pretty much go to, you have this big skills gap between what universities teach and what companies want. So that's why every company, especially in IT, once they recruit somebody from university, what's the first thing they do?
They teach them.
Yeah, put them on a training program, right? A few weeks, a couple of months, put them on a training program. But that training program is very expensive. You're paying him or her salary, and you're, you know, running a training cost, and you're not generating revenue. And after the training is done, what happens in China is, if you're a good company like an IBM or a, you know, Tata or Infosys or Accenture, whatever, once the training is done, the local companies, they come and poach these participants, these kids. And they say, okay, I give you $100 more a month. $100 more? Okay, let's go. So they finish the training and then they're gone. Now the company is again left struggling. You know, so what we did was we had a training program that focused on all these things that you try to train in your company. We'll take that. We'll do all of that for you. We'll find the kids, we'll find the students, we'll train them, we'll make them sort of first day work ready. So when they come to your company, instead of doing a 2-month training program, you just do maybe a 2-week program where you just talk about the things that are very unique to your company, the things that we cannot teach your company's internal policies, procedures, etc., etc. So that was something that we did. And that was also a very successful business because within 3 years, we were doing about 5,000 students a year and placing them with 100% placement. And this venture was very exciting because this was a partnership between, you know, a local city government, a top university in China, IBM, an IT company in China, and myself. So the partners in this and structuring all of this was very, very interesting and very challenging at the same time. Because then you learn how to work with so many partners. And basically, they're investors. They're like investors, right? So how do you play with all of them? And everybody has different objectives and so on. 2012, we also sold that business and had a good exit. And then since then, I've been doing a lot of angel investing and working with startups, mentoring startups, advising them, growing them. I am very deeply involved, for example, with Chinaccelerator, which is the number one accelerator in China. And I'll tell you more about that and so on. And I continue to build upon that. So like I said, my family is based in Japan. So I am helping one of the local regional governments in Japan to try and build an entrepreneurial ecosystem there. This is in the Osaka region in Japan. I've made frequent trips here to Ukraine. Oftentimes I give some lectures at some of the business schools and also again try to engage with the entrepreneurial community and see what kind of opportunities exist and so on. And from then on, yeah, that's the you know, that's how things have been built.
You come to Ukraine rather often.
Quite often. I think this is my, In the last 2.5 years, this is my ninth trip.
And when was the first one, and why?
The first one, actually, I came to give some lectures in Lviv, with Lviv Business School.
Okay.
So they have a fantastic master's MS technology program.
And how they found you? You know, like, why, how, you know, like, it's very interesting, you know, like, how people, you know, like, approach such kind of people like you.
Okay, so my engagement with Ukraine's goes way back 2004, something like that, because one of my very best friends in China is Ukrainian.
Oh.
Yeah, and he's also, I think, quite famous here already also. His name is Serhiy Lesniak, and he's the author of a translated book of The Art of War.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So he's translated that into Ukrainian, and he's published it here. I think it was number one, number two on the bestseller list here for many, many weeks and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So he's one of my best friends. And with him, you know, we started looking at various Ukrainian businesses. Essentially, anytime a Ukrainian business or entity or person was coming to Shanghai, they all meet him because he's the center of the Ukrainian community in China in many ways.
Mm-hmm.
So they would meet him, and then he would say, hey, Manmeet, come, just let's talk. You know, they want to understand something about China or business here, so let's just talk to them. So like that, I've met like literally probably hundreds of different businesses and businessmen and so on. And that's how things sort of built up.
So
Lviv guys were coming there, and we met and so on, just bit by bit.
So big thanks to Sergey, who was a good
evangelist. Oh, absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. He is, he most definitely is.
Yeah. And as far as I know, that you have some businesses also here in Ukraine. I mean that you have some also partnerships, not only that you come to have lectures in business schools, but you also have some, you know, like partnership with business.
Yes, I mean to some extent. So there are a couple of startups here that I am advising and sort of working with. I think they are still in stealth mode, so we won't talk too much about them right now. But yeah, so there are a couple of these kind of companies. Then I do work fairly closely with some of the business schools, like kmbs, for instance, or even Lviv Business School. And I'm also have the pleasure of being associated with this Kyiv International Economic Forum. So they have this forum every year. They've done it the last 2 years. And they invite, you know, attendees from all over the world. And the major theme of the forum is effectively how to, you know, what to do for Ukraine's economy and its growth and so on. So I'm working with them, and in fact, you know, we're looking at how to get deeper engagement between Ukraine and Asia.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be a significant theme also of the next forum that we'll have this year.
Mm-hmm.
So like that, I think there are various engagements that I have or people that I'm
mm-hmm.
meeting and trying to help and so on.
Do you work with, you know, like the representative, you know, like agencies, implementing agencies, donor organizations like JICA, you know, like Japan? Oh my God, I forgot.
You mean those agencies here?
Yeah, like development agencies.
No, like JBIC or something, you mean?
Yeah, something like this, and also, you know, like embassies who are supporting, you know, like Ukraine. No, nothing like this.
Okay, so when it comes to embassies, I'm usually a little, I think it's better to go directly to
the
businesses.
Okay.
I think embassies and all, you know, my dad worked in embassies, so I have a fair experience. That's why I travel, yes. So I have a fair experience with that. I think embassies are great in terms of maybe making connections as much, but you know, not much beyond that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if you really want to build relationships or understand an environment, you kind of have to just go there, be there,
mm-hmm.
spend time, invest in it,
mm-hmm.
And build relationships, and then from there you start finding the right opportunities.
So meetups, conferences, you know, like hubs.
Meetups, it doesn't even have to be that. I mean, a couple of times I've just come.
Just
took a flight and came and set up some meetings and meet five people, and five people introduced me to another 10 people.
Okay.
And by the time I'm leaving, I've got, you know, 40, 50 business cards and different ideas and thoughts and so on. And you build up from there, right? As an accelerator, so, you know, quick background is that Chinaccelerator is the first, and I think we think it's the most successful accelerator that we have in China. One of the major themes for Chinaccelerator is that you do this world to Asia. So all the international teams that Chinaccelerator invests in, we actually bring them to penetrate the Chinese market. So come to Chinaccelerator predominantly for penetrating and working into the Chinese market. Let me see, it's the other way around. And with the Chinese companies that we have there, the investment theme effectively is these are, you know, great companies locally. They might be international teams, they might be local teams, doesn't matter. But the idea is to provide them through the network that we have, provide them access for growth globally, not just within the domestic. So it's a very differentiated kind of strategy, right? It's not hardcore local for local, it's international for China or China for the globe. And that's a large part of the investment theme. We are in an environment where mobile first, mobile only is the answer. If you look at the ecosystem in China, you look at the ecosystem even now, for instance, in India, you know, Asia is very, very rapidly being the region with the most mobile connections. It's the region where most business is purely mobile. In India, for instance, the fact of the matter is we went from, you know, very low internet penetration. We skipped the PC desktop phase and we're all on mobiles now. We have one of the fastest growing smartphones market in India today. And businesses are adapting to that, right? So a major part of the theme for us is mobile first, mobile only.
It's only in India, it's in China.
China as well. Yeah, I'm sure you've come across this phrase, the next 5 billion, right? So the next 5 billion customers, consumers and all are going to be the ones who are coming online for the first time via mobile. They're not coming through the desktops. They're not coming through the web experience. They're coming straight onto mobile. So that's where we're looking at. We're not looking at where things are today. We're sort of looking at where things will be going forward. And you look at markets across, you look at South America, you look at Africa. I think there's a good article, if you Google the next 5 billion, there's a good article with Eric Schmidt from Google. He talked about their experience traveling in many countries and finding where you have, you know, communities that probably aren't very literate or don't have much resources, but they are communicating over some form of smartphone, or they're doing transactions over smartphones and so on. They're doing commerce over smartphones. So that's an interesting element there. The program is a three-month program. So all the startups that we invest in come to Shanghai, for instance, for Chinaccelerator. We also have another accelerator called MOX, M-O-X, and that's pretty much the mobile first, mobile only accelerator. And that one is based in Taiwan. We just started and we are in the middle of our first batch there. In all cases, it's a three-month program. Resident teams come, they work in our office spaces, basically 24/7. We help and arrange for all their basic needs and so on. It's the structure of the program is effectively, we provide not only the platform for them to grow, but one of the biggest things that Chinaccelerator has as an advantage is the mentor network. So we've got over 150 mentors, right? And access to these people is one of the biggest things that the startups get. You get the investment, $50,000 for 7% or sometimes even more. We have about 10, 12, 14 companies in each batch, two batches a year, right? All of that is there, but the one of the, you know, one of the largest edge and advantages you have is to have this massive network of mentors that are there, accessible, available at any time for startups to go get advice from, get help from, get guidance from, and sometimes, oftentimes, actually partnerships from, right?
And what is the interest to be a mentor of the accelerator?
There are multiple things. I think for some, it's a way to keep in touch with what's happening. Mm-hmm. For some people, it's honestly a pay it forward. Okay. So I got into mentorship, honestly, for paying forward. When I was struggling as an entrepreneur, there were tons of successful people that I went to for help, and they helped. I mean, without, there was nothing I could give them. The equity was worthless, cash didn't exist. So I had nothing to give them. They kept giving and giving, and that was of immense value. Mm-hmm. You know, so you end up as an entrepreneur in many cases, you end up actually paying it forward and you help and advise. Because if you grow the ecosystem, mm-hmm. at some point some opportunity might show up, fine. But, you know, part of the whole, I think, entrepreneur ethos is that you want this ecosystem, you want the community to grow and flourish. Mm-hmm. So that's for most of them, that's it. We don't pay mentors.
Okay. And I'm asking this because in some, you know, like schemes of, you know, like accelerators,
yeah.
They also take, you know, like some pool of the equity of the fund who actually invest in this accelerator. So maybe they have some shares or something like this.
Okay, so... I'll come to that in just a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
One of the other important things to understand about how we operate is that we're always looking for unfair advantage. It's another sort of theme within the investment thesis. And the unfair advantage idea is basically, you know, if you're going to compete in China, for instance, where any business can be replicated instantaneously, and you have multiple teams running in, so you can have... I'll give you an example. When Groupon sort of first started in China, we had within a few months, we had over 5,000 clones for Groupon, right? 5,000, no jokes. So that replication is fast. Does that mean that, you know, it's not a market worth targeting because somebody can clone you? Well, of course it's worth targeting. Just because you clone an idea doesn't mean shit, right? It's the execution of the idea. It's how you actually work on it, how you understand your market, how you build your product, how fast you iterate and improve your product and service to fit the market needs. That's the real edge, right? It's not the idea. Ideas are worth nothing. It's always about execution, in my view, and I think most of our view. So we're looking for those kind of unfair advantage scenarios where you have, you know, killer team, killer idea, et cetera, et cetera.
And what about IPR? You know, like we have... some rumors, you know, like everyone is saying that in China, for example, if you have a patent or you have some idea which is patented, it worth nothing because, as you said, everything can be duplicated. So what is the attitude of investors for the patents? Is it so important to have a patent or it's important to have interesting, you know, like successful...
Yeah,
implementation of
China actually has fairly good IPR laws, right?
True.
It has a system. The problem is, if you didn't understand those rules, regulations first,
uh-huh.
and you didn't then accordingly go to take the right steps to protect your patent,
uh-huh.
then it's your fault. Now, to say that, you know, there's a lot of copying going on in China, sure. But then if you look back at the economic development of various other nations, if we look back at, you know, Korean development, you look at some of the stuff that was happening in Japan early on, I mean, lots of business models, lots of ideas were copied, right? Today, I don't think China is in any way sort of the copy central. Yes, if there's a good business idea, they'll take it and they'll run with it.
Patent will impact the cost of the project or not?
It will, but a lot of times you don't have to patent something.
Yeah, right.
Because again, just because somebody has your idea doesn't mean they can execute it.
True.
Right? I mean, simple, forget IT, forget startups, okay? If I say Japanese cars, what do you think about them?
Quality.
Quality, yeah? Mm-hmm. If I say American cars, what do you think about them? big, strong, quality?
Yes. Yes.
At least some questions for some brands, some cars, yes? Mm-hmm. Now, the Japanese way of manufacturing, and especially the Toyota way of manufacturing, called the Toyota way, there are case studies and books and articles. You can go and take trips. You can actually see the Toyota factory. You know everything about how to do it. It's well documented. Yet, there are dozens of car brands that don't implement it. Why? It's not that easy. Just knowing something doesn't mean shit. It's how you execute on it. You see what I'm saying? So just because some startup, you know, having a startup idea is great, but what's the reality of startups? When you build a startup, you realize my first idea was bullshit. The market is telling me something else. Now I've got to do what? I've got to iterate. I've got to change. How quickly do you change? How effective do you change? How well do you know your customer? How well do you know the future needs of your customer before maybe even they know about it? Right? And how quickly can your team, your systems, your processes, and everything scale up, advance? So many factors come into play that somebody who's merely copying an idea without a strong execution base just cannot compete with. So if you want to be ahead, you can always innovate and, you know your customer, your market that much better. Get from today's idea to the next idea to the next idea. The guys behind you are copying. What are they doing? They're always going to be behind you, right? You take one idea and you just sit on it, mm-hmm. and then somebody copies and takes it. Well, that's your fault. I make a coffee shop. I make nice cakes and nice cookies. Somebody comes right next door, makes the same coffee shop, and I don't change. Whose fault? His or mine? Right?
True. Yeah, so, that's also true.
I think that's the mentality we should take when it comes to these kind of
questions.
Yeah. And By far, China is not today in any means, especially in the startup ecosystem, a copycat model place. I mean, all you need to do is look at some of the online services and all that we use in China, and you'll have a sense. Any of you use WeChat, for instance?
I've heard of it. Never used it.
Okay, so, you know,
so
just...
one person is using it, WeChat.
What do you think about WeChat?
WeChat, yeah, it's right. It's very popular. If you have a contact there, in China, just...
Yeah, I mean, 650 million users on that thing, yeah? But I think it's monthly active users or daily active users. Now, this is a platform. This is on your mobile, Android, iOS, whatever you have. It's a very basic platform that is, if you look at it, it's like a combination. The best way for me to describe it, it's imagine all the best of Facebook and Twitter and, you know, e-commerce market like an eBay and so on, mobile branding, mobile commerce, a payment platform, everything on this one platform. You don't even need to make sites anymore. It's a wonderful social network for you to stay in touch with friends and families, right? You have every kind of communication possible, video calls, text messages, groups, multiple groups, push out notifications. I mean, it covers all personal social networks. It covers brands. So brands actually have entire commerce sites in WeChat, right? And you can buy and sell directly on it. Anybody can, with a company and proper registration of a company, you can set up your own official account. You can build your commerce site right on it in the native app. You don't even get out of it. That's supremely powerful. You know, if you're doing marketing in China today for consumers, this is the platform that everybody has to find a solution for. How do you go on that and distinguish yourself? Now, is that a copy? You can sit and say, oh yeah, it's a copy. They have this part in Facebook. You have this part on Twitter. You have this part on this site. Yeah, but I think that's bullshit because somebody sat there and took some of these ideas, but then made it completely different and for the local market and built it that way and has that kind of traction and that kind of daily usage and so on, right? That's completely different. That's a whole different story, right? You should check out WeChat and see if on my card, I'll leave the card here because I'm on my last one, but there's a QR code and that's, you know, for you to connect with me. Most of us in China now, we hardly use email to communicate with each other. Everything is through our WeChat feeds. Any other questions on that?
I have a question, but we can continue.
Okay. So, yeah, so, you know, when we're talking about some of this advantages that we have, the mentor network is awesome. We've got this alumni network. I mean, actually, Chinaccelerator is part of a fund called SOSV, which was launched by a gentleman named Sean O'Sullivan. And it's effectively his personal fund. It's, I think, $235-260 million evergreen fund. And then we have five different accelerators. So his investment thesis is he'll invest through accelerators that they set up. So two of those accelerators are China Accelerator and MOX, based in China. We have a hardware accelerator in Shenzhen called HAX. I don't know if you guys know. You guys know a company called Pets Cube?
Yeah,
so Pets Cube is a graduate from HAX as well, right? And then there are a couple of other, IndieBio is another, I think, health tech accelerator, and then there's a food accelerator as well. And food accelerator just recently, if you look on my Facebook feed, you'll see it. They just came up with this pork meat that comes directly from cells, so you don't have to grow pigs anymore to have this meat. And it's not sort of some fake meat. It's actually from actual live cells, and they've cultured the pork meat. So these are the kind of ideas and problems and global issues that they're trying to. So different accelerators for different purposes. And then we have these experts in residence. So the experts in residence are guys like me. So there are a few of us, and we are very deeply involved with every team in every batch, especially like for my case with China Accelerator and now with MOX. I focus on a certain theme, like their financial modeling, their financial structure and business plan and so on. That's something that I focus on with every team. So we spend somewhere between, 8-10 hours a week with each of the teams to provide them that kind of expertise. There are a few other people who take different roles. I think I can show you those. Yeah, this is just a photo of some of the 150 mentors. And these are the who's who of people who've built businesses, run companies in China, large companies, startups, all kinds of experience. That kind of a network is just impossible to come by. Mm-hmm. It takes time to build something like this and to get people to contribute. Each one of these people, immediately accessible. Startups can directly contact them, no problem whatsoever. Right. That's the play. Mm-hmm. Here are some profiles of some of the mentors. I mean, if you think about it, so here's a very famous, James, a very famous, well-regarded VC in China. Dianping is effectively like a Groupon, the largest Groupon type site in China. So he's senior manager there, Jason. Andy is a guy who built on WeChat, from 0 to 20 million followers in 18 months. So when I say that WeChat is the predominant marketing platform in China today, here's an expert who's done it. Yeah. Who better to tell you how to build your followers on that, right? Head of community for WeChat, Richard Robinson, a serial entrepreneur, one of the few successful foreign entrepreneurs in China. You know how many foreigners have built companies in China that went IPO? Yeah. Three. That's it, three. All of China. Later. Only three of them. Richard is one of them. Yeah. And so on. So some of the caliber. And then here are sort of the experts. So Armand, for example, he works exclusively on like the investment pitch. He's a seasoned investment banker. He worked with SVB. He's been investing in startups for decades. He knows Silicon Valley. He worked in India with SVB as well. So he's got, global expertise from a career from Silicon Valley Bank. And he's the guy who works with every team on their investment pitch. I work on financial modeling. So I don't know if you guys have here, I'm guessing you do, but have you heard of TBWA? And one of the largest media agencies globally. So their chief strategy officer, Milo, he's another expert in residence. And he works with each of the, just like I work on financial modeling, he works on, you know, their media strategy and their branding and PR and so on. Same with Beth Ann or Ryan. Everybody's an expert in their fields from the industry, providing very specific, dedicated guidance to each of the teams. In terms of partners, I'm sure a lot of these names won't ring a bell for you, but each one of these entities is a very well-established either media agency or an investment entity or a marketing company or all the kinds of entities that startups need as partners for their growth, for their branding, for their outreach, for their customer acquisition, whatever have you, right? They're all direct partners. They provide a lot of services to our companies. So our then value when we invest in companies is much, much more than the cash. In fact, the cash is almost insignificant because of all the strategic help and the benefits that you get from all these partnerships. Each one of these immediately available. I'll give you an example. This OMD. OMD is one of the biggest marketing agencies in China. So I remember when we were talking about videotaping. So we videotape our startups, giving their pitch and describing themselves and so on, professionally done. In Shanghai, almost every public taxi has a screen on the back seat, right? So the front passenger seat on the back headrest, there's a screen with constant looped advertisements and some engagement models. We had our videos of all our startups running on those taxis all across the city.
Really?
Yes, all through this partnership with OMD. The largest outdoor digital sign in Shanghai, right in the city center, was constantly playing our startup's videos to, you know, everybody walking that street. I mean, it's the center of Shanghai. So you, how much money does it take to buy that?
A lot.
You get it for free.
Oh, you're for free.
It's for free. Startups don't pay for it. Our startups don't pay for it. That's the value of partnerships. How do you get such partnerships? Then OMD is also an investor in the startups. They also have a competition and they select the best three startups and they invest in them as well, right? So that kind of collaboration, that kind of access to value that accelerates your growth, that's what makes us very, very, I think, different. Mm-hmm. Brands. So you had your Open Data Hackathon. We do a bunch of these hackathons with brands, like with Visa or with Danone. I was part of one with Budweiser. Right, so Anheuser-Busch, Budweiser. So Budweiser was looking at how to engage deeper with their audience. And they had specific targets. It's confidential, so I can't get into details. But we brought some of our relevant startups for an open hackathon between the Budweiser team, our guys, who have certain services in their business model that is we think is interesting. And there was a joint partnership built around that, right? So we do that with various other brands and build on those networks and so on that we have. And that, I mean, you know, if you're a startup and you're doing something in, I don't know, marketing, and Budweiser becomes one of your first clients,
yeah.
How much better proof of concept do you need? Or you are a fintech startup and Visa becomes your first client? Okay, you know, that's powerful. Then you go for fundraising, that's a different story then, right? And that's the idea here. Here are some of the brands that we partner with. Here are some of the companies that we've invested in. One of our most famous ones is this company called Order With Me, which graduated in 2011 from Chinaccelerator. And then they won TechCrunch Disrupt. And then they've raised now more than three rounds of funding now. They're based in Las Vegas and so on now. Highly successful company, and these others equally so. Small team, very tight, small team, the core team that works there. Apart from us, four or five experts in residence. This is the team, and William is the investment partner of SOS, who runs all of these two accelerators, China Accelerator and Mox, right? So William comes from investment banking background. He was an award-winning equity analyst first, then he became a VC. He was a VC with SoftBank China India. Then he was also with Innovate, a Singtel. Singtel is the largest Singaporean telecom company. He was a VC with them, all in China. So he has tremendous experience. He's probably one of the most networked guys I have ever met. Across the globe, across the globe. I mean, absolutely insane network, you know. So he's the guy running it all. And this is SOSV. And these are the various accelerators that we have that I mentioned.
So it's like a family of accelerators.
It is. It's the accelerator VC. Mm-hmm. It's the accelerator VC. For those of you who understand the economics of accelerators or VC funds, 38% net IRR, that's
huge.
It's massive.
The biggest one?
One of the biggest. I mean, I think that puts us easily in the top 5% of VCs globally, mm-hmm. with those returns. Mm-hmm. And when you think about that, it's one man's vision, one man's effectively capital, who's an entrepreneur himself. Sean O'Sullivan is actually the guy who is also credited with coining the term cloud computing. You know, I think it was, what was it, MapInfo that he was, he had co-founded and sold and, you know, mm-hmm. exited from, and then he built from there. You know, every time when you, on a map, when you put an address mm-hmm. and that location icon shows up on the location there, that's something he developed way back when. Yeah, please.
My question is, how many companies aggregated this between
How many companies? It's a fund. So this would be, I don't know. I don't know the exact number of companies, but I think we're looking at a few hundred companies.
And it's global. It's not only Chinese, or it's only Chinese?
Global. Anybody can come to China Accelerator. I've whenever we have a new batch, I always post on my Facebook, or I send out to friends here in Ukraine as well, and say, hey, anybody who wants to look and penetrate into the China market, reach out to me and we'll you know, talk about it. So far, zero. Here's the thing. Chinese market is massive, but it's not easy.
True.
So one thing, you know, when people talk about, I want to grow my startup in China, I want to tap the Chinese market. The one thing we always kind of ask is, you know, are you ready to be in China? You cannot sit in Ukraine and tap China market. Forget it. It's not happening. So if you want to do China, then you better get your ass in China. You better, at least one of the co-founders and a core team should be based in China. So that's why ours is a residence program. If you can't even come and stay there, then you are not committed enough to the market.
How long? This residence program.
10 years.
No, the program is 3 months. The program is 3 months, right? But then after that, if you want to build a business in China, you have to be on the ground. China changes and grows very rapidly. I mean, just think about it, you know, from a country that was closed, an economy that was completely antiquated 30 years ago to the second largest economy in the world. 30 years, it's a different pace of growth.
Chinese. This is maybe,
yeah, you have to learn. It's so a good idea to learn.
First, I need to learn Chinese and then to go to China. Or
no,
I can go to China to spend the 3 months.
Do it all. Do it all simultaneously.
Words, but
yeah.
How you know, like, just for me to understand, for other guys
yeah.
to understand. Is it possible, for example, I used to live in Germany, but in Germany everyone speaks English.
Mm.
I just use my German maybe 3 times in a month,
yeah.
but everyone speaks, you know, like
yeah.
English.
Yeah.
What about China? What about China and business development?
It's getting better and better with English, but if you are looking at targeting the Chinese consumer market, you have to know Chinese. At least some senior person on your team who's driving that local engagement and biz dev and so on has got to be Chinese. Mm-hmm. Even your team, you know, a lot of your team might not be able to speak English. A lot of your developers might not be able. So how do you communicate with them?
Mm-hmm.
Right? And don't tell me, yeah, coding is all in English and blah, blah, because, you know, if you don't communicate the idea to your coder, it's not going to not going to work. It's about the collaboration. So you've got to be committed to this market. That's one thing. You know, China's not easy and China's not quick to give you returns. But if you're committed to the market and you stay and you learn and you understand it, and then you navigate it, you make mega returns. But you have to be committed.
Do you help also for such teams like mine, for example?
Yeah. So you know, the idea is first you've got to be sure that you want to commit to China market, mm-hmm. right? And then, you know, we talk about your product and we think of ourselves about the opportunity in the market, who are the competitors and so on. Mm-hmm. You know, if it's something that we think, yeah, that's interesting, mm-hmm. then we'd invite you.
And can you help me also to increase my team to find someone who can help?
Yes, to some
professional who is Chinese, who is whom I can, you know, like be confident in, you know, like.
Yeah, to some extent, but honestly, you need to develop your team. See, in building a startup, one of the biggest challenges is
team, yeah.
building your team.
Yeah.
If you cannot get the right people to join you, what makes you think you'll get the right customers to buy from you? Right? So we make connections, but we really encourage, at least when you come, you should at least be, you know, one founder or at least one CTO,
yeah,
right?
Of course.
To build, if you're coming without even a CTO, I think that's very challenging.
But if I have CTO, if I have, for example, a person who is a business developer in, US,
yeah.
you know, like I have, you know, like a development team again in
yeah.
Ukraine.
Yeah.
But for me, it's very interesting to go to China, Chinese market.
So
it's challenging, of course, for me, but, you know, like I don't know Chinese. I have doubts that I will learn Chinese as a Chinese.
Well, most every university in Shanghai,
mm-hmm.
they have these intensive Chinese language courses for foreigners,
mm-hmm.
and basically you enroll in this, and from morning to evening you're basically studying Chinese and you're talking in Chinese and you're going out and ordering in Chinese and all this kind of stuff. Within 6 months, your conversational Chinese becomes really good. In fact, I think you pretty much become in the top 5% of foreigners in China who actually speak Chinese. You understand? But it's just about a 6 month commitment and working hard. And I think if you want that size of an opportunity, then you got to work for that, right?
Mm-hmm.
As far as, you know, like I said, finding other team members and so on, the network is huge. Your opportunity to find the right people is huge,
mm-hmm.
but you've got to be the one putting the effort into it. Right? The team is your team. It's for you.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to have to put a lot of effort in finding the guys.
And you mentioned that you are well connected all over the world.
The SOS, SOSV and our accelerators through that and the SOSV network, there's absolutely a global network. No doubt about that.
If you will choose my startup to come to China and to have this program for 3 months, how my life during these 3 months will look like? Maybe you can. You said that eight hours per week I will spend with mentors.
Yeah.
They will be educational, you know, like program which will be all the days.
Yeah, but it's
business development.
Okay, so
how it's look like, you know, like. Everything what you showed for us, it's very tasty and very, you know, like attractive, but, you know, like to know more details. Maybe, you know, like such kind of questions will help to increase from zero to more companies to come to China. No.
If you're a startup, in many cases, you are literally devoting your entire time to building this business.
Yeah.
It's not easy to build a startup. It's extremely difficult. So you have to devote. I do not, personally, I don't believe in you should be 24 hours working on this. I think you need to sleep, at least. I remember one startup we had, and one of the most dedicated guys I've ever seen. I mean, this guy was literally sleeping in the office every day. right? And only for a few hours, and he was working nonstop. At one point, I actually wrote him an email, and I said, "Bud, you need to sleep. You know, my advice to you right now is forget everything, go home, and sleep for a few hours. You know, take a shower, and then think about, you know, and then come back." But I don't think you have to be. You don't have to be like that. Many are like that. But at the same time, if you're building a startup, I don't think you have too much time to run around and party every weekend or live a corporate lifestyle, which is, you know, whatever, 9 to 6, 7, whatever it is, then I got to go home, I relax, I'm not so sure that that's possible. Mm-hmm. Not if you are trying to build things fast, if you're building on a sort of lean startup kind of principle, and you're iterating rapidly and so on, then no. For speed, you got to be always on. Yeah?
This guy was Indian or Chinese?
No, he's Western.
Okay, and from US, yes, right? How he ended up?
Well, how does that matter?
Because they are the hardworking people and not hardworking nations, for example. I'm Georgian. Georgians are not hardworking.
I don't know about that.
I'm not mentioning other nations.
Sure, sure.
So, the next question is how he ended up, he started.
Oh, he'd been based in Asia for many years, and he had an idea. And then he spent 3 years before coming to Chinaccelerator. He spent 3 years literally building his idea manually.
Western, you mean Western world?
North America.
That's US style, most likely either Silicon Valley or New York. So they are crazy about that. Okay.
Yeah. I think, I have a different view on these things, and let me try it out. I'll throw it out. I think it's very difficult to generalize that entire nations, whichever nations there might be, are A or B. My experience has been in every country I go, you always have a normal distribution of people across different metrics. So we talk about, these people, in this country, people are very lazy, or they're very evil, or they're very good. I've always found that you have an absolutely normal distribution. You have a group of people that are really lazy, and then you have a group of people that are really hardworking, and you have this whole thing in between. Mm-hmm. It's also part of a culture, right? So that makes some things different to some extent. The culture element. So I think when you think about New York, or you think about Silicon Valley, there's a culture there because there's an ecosystem,
and it's like kind of KPI. It's not about all the nation. It's like kind of KPI, right?
Yeah, but how do you build the culture? You start building that ecosystem.
Yeah.
Yes.
You see, if you don't have the ecosystem, obviously you're not going to have the culture. Before, when if I talk about my own country, India, for instance, we used to consider that we are hardworking. But if you look at our bureaucracy, it's the laziest, slowest bureaucracy in the world, right? That's our internal belief. But then what changed, right? The system, the economy started changing, economy opened up, people started seeing others getting rich or whatever, thinking, shit, wow, money is a good thing. And now there are ways of making money in the private sector, and we can build our own startups. So I'm going to work hard for that. Then there are a few success stories that help accelerate that hunger, right?
Government change.
Well, every 5 years, government changes in India.
Is a young prime minister, central bank.
You're talking about India?
Yeah.
A lot of it has to do with the image and the track record of the current prime minister. But India's economic growth started way back in like 91. So it's many other governments in between. It's not just this guy, but it's a different culture. I'll give an example of this cultural thing. What I'm trying to get at, one of the biggest things I feel in all my trips here is that everybody's always frustrated and complaining about local government, whatever shape or form. There's this constant unhappiness. I understand it. I come from a country where we have had similar issues in many ways, right? But in India, we kind of joke. We say like China grew because of the government. India grows despite the government. you know, or India grows at night when the government is asleep. I mean, what that basically effectively means is that people are building their own businesses. They're building their own opportunities. They're finding it. And they're doing their own thing. They're not, we never waited for the government to do things for us. So our growth is slower, but it's more internal. Right? It's led by local individuals, right? As opposed to how China grew, which is very much a government push. So it'll take us longer, but because it's actually, you know, from the ground up, it's a different kind of growth. And I think that's something that might be useful here. Is if, you know, we stop waiting for government to give us stuff, and like you, start up something. You've got a great idea, and that product I think is very, very interesting, right? And it has global market ambitions, and so that's the kind of stuff that's required.
Yeah.
But that's a culture, and I think that over time will come. In India too, it didn't come when I was in my MBA program. Everybody wanted to either join, like, you know, finance or Goldman Sachs and all that kind of stuff, investment banking or McKinsey and all. Today in most business schools, I think something like 30% odd of MBA grads don't want to take a job.
They want to
start their own business, or they want to join a startup, right? I mean, I graduated from MBA in 2001, we're in 2016.
It's only 15 years.
Even less, right? That complete shift in mental attitude. Right. The other thing is that now failure is accepted. We understand that startups have to fail. You have to fail at some point to learn from it and so on. Very rarely are you successful with your first idea and you move up.
And can you tell us what kind of you know, like industries or what kind of startups would be interesting for the Chinese market, for the Asian market specifically?
I think one of the biggest stories in Asia right now is the consumer story, right? The middle class.
So B2C or, you know, C?
It is. But at the same time, all these businesses have to learn to adapt to a digital world.
Mm-hmm.
And
to mobile
world. Major companies globally are having to completely relearn what it means, what the customer journey means, mm-hmm. right? What does it mean when you talk about customer relationship management? It's no longer just keeping a database. Mm-hmm. It's much, much more than that. How to engage with them and so on.
Have
proper relations in a digital world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you have completely online banks or completely online experiences, then what does it mean? What is that customer and how do you... So brands, corporations, they're all trying to learn and figure out
like
how to deal with this.
More psychology, you know, like involved.
Possible, that's certainly part of it. So in that environment, then you have the B2B plays, which cover that.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, then if you forget, you know, these two big themes, you have so many other sort of industrial themes or verticals that you can think of,
mm-hmm.
right? Anything and all the, pick all the keywords you want.
Mm-hmm.
Artificial intelligence, you know. Pollution and the environment are huge issues in Asia.
Mm-hmm.
So energy efficiency is huge issues. We're still predominantly coal burning countries.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, anything in that,
mm-hmm.
You name it. And take any of the major ills that we have in terms of healthcare or in terms of, you know, caring for the aged or disease prevention or anything in education. Education models today are some of the most antiquated models ever. That's one industry that needs serious
mm-hmm.
disruption.
And what about disabilities? Disabilities, you know, like...
Disabilities. Asia is very intolerant towards disabilities. We have intolerant in the sense, you know, I live in Japan and everywhere you go, they have access for disabled. Right, it's also a very aged society.
Mm-hmm.
But if you go in China or you go in India, almost negligible.
Mm-hmm.
Public transportation, hotels, shopping malls. I don't really notice much that is there for disabled.
Mm-hmm.
So anything to help in that, sure. And you have to understand, you know, in many cases, disabled is considered another, what to say, you know, tarnish on the family, like, oh, I got this disabled kid, you know, so it's embarrassing, as opposed to, yeah, I got a special child.
Mm-hmm. And if you are breaking these walls, you know, like of...
I think that's a good thing.
And is the community ready for that? culturally.
Who's ever ready for disruption until you bring it?
Okay. Disruptive.
But the amount of change that these markets have gone through over the last 20, 30 years, I don't think there's any other market that I can think of that is more ready for change than these, because they've gone through such dramatic change already.
Mm-hmm. Which, most successful startups are in China now, and in which fields? What do they do? So you called WeChat, which is,
WeChat is not a startup anymore. It's...
Okay. But what kind of...
I'll tell you, I can tell you about some of our startups that have already graduated, for instance, right? Mm-hmm. So we've got this one startup called Squirrels. So Squirrels is a very interesting idea. The amount of waste that China's manufacturing produces, or any manufacturing produces, is phenomenal, mm-hmm. right? Now, this waste either goes into landfills and becomes a environmental problem, or it gets burnt, which itself is another environmental issue. Mm-hmm. So what Squirrels does is they take waste or rejects from factories. Mm-hmm. First, right now, they're focusing a lot more on things like textiles and fabrics and leather and rubber and these kind of things. Mm-hmm. And they work with these factories rather than throwing it away. Mm-hmm. They actually collect this and then they link it to a whole network of designers who use this waste material as raw material for creations. Mm-hmm. Then they make these creations, and then Squirrels also has a B2C platform for selling this.
Creative industry.
Absolutely,
startup.
Absolutely. And this is called upcycling, mm-hmm. where you don't change the form of the material and you make something new with it. So for instance, one of the things they did was, in hospitals you wear these gowns, and if the gowns were the wrong color, they got rejected. Or the fabric was a little something, they got rejected. Mm. So they took these surgical gowns and they converted them into bags.
Okay.
Like beautiful, messenger bags, totes, mm-hmm. and stuff like that.
For conferences, for example.
And then you can use it anywhere. So you can go to their site, thesquirrels.com, and they're doing fantastically well. That's one idea. Something different is another company we have called BitMEX. So BitMEX is fantastic. BitMEX is actually an international team. Here's where even we are flexible. The CTO is American and actually was based in the US. Mm-hmm. Two other co-founders, one is American, one's British, were actually from Hong Kong. They were investment bankers. And they've built this entire Bitcoin-based derivative trading platform.
So Bitcoins is also a trend.
Yeah, sure. China is one of the biggest markets for that. And so they've built an entire Bitcoin trading platform for derivatives. So it's not trading, it's not Bitcoin to hard currency and vice versa. Mm-hmm. It's actually, if you have Bitcoins, now you can trade a whole bunch of derivatives with leverage, in fact. Mm-hmm. Right? And the trading platform, if you look at it, it looks almost like like a Bloomberg terminal. It's that complex, that mm-hmm. advanced. That's another one that we've invested in that I really love.
Creative industry, fintech.
You name it. Mm-hmm. You name it. What else? We have an excellent one in insurance right now that does P2P insurance. Mm-hmm. It's called Tongjubao. And what these guys do is, the traditional insurance industry, the insurance company takes the risk. You pay them premium, they collect the premium, and then they take the risk. And then when there is some payment, they pay out from the pool. But what if we forget the insurance company? What if all of us in this room, we take some insurance, for our phones. If we drop our phone and break it, we have insurance, okay? So all of us put the money together into the pool, and Tongjubao provides the platform. If the phone breaks, you get some money, whatever fixed amount that we all agree to, everybody gets to fix their phone. When the money is running out from the pool, then you start reducing the payments. Or if it's gone, you also have a backup with an actual insurance company. Fine. But if it doesn't run out, if there's money left over, what do you do with that? Give it back. Insurance companies don't give it back.
Yeah.
Here you get it back. Mm-hmm. And the beauty of this is, imagine if we were all office workers or colleagues or lived in the same area. I know you, you know me. If I broke my phone, you're thinking, wait a minute, how did you break the phone? I didn't see you break the phone. Or, you know, you're making this up. There's a community that can oversee what's happening. You know, if we are insuring our cars and you are constantly claiming damage to your car, but your car is always parked downstairs. I've seen it. Mm-hmm. So how the hell is it damaged? I've seen it. You understand what I mean? Or I know what you're doing. So they're not, and they're doing this kind of model, and not only are they doing the model, they're doing completely different insurance. Not car insurance or house insurance, traditional stuff. Mm-hmm. Insurance against divorce. So if you're getting divorced, then you will get a fixed amount of money every month for 12 months. Mm-hmm. Because if you're getting divorced, typically, you know, money becomes an issue. Mm-hmm. Especially for the partner who's not earning. Right? Or if your child fails an exam. In Asia, we have extra classes that we send our kids to outside of school. The school never teaches enough. So to compete, you send them to extra classes. That costs a lot of money. We spend thousands a month for something like that. Mm-hmm. So what happens if your kid fails? They have to take the exam again next year, mm-hmm. which means I got to pay for those coaching classes again. Mm-hmm. Now I have some insurance to back that up. Or for kidnapping. I mean, they're coming up with very creative
ways of insurance.
Ways of insurance or things or risks to insure against. Mm-hmm. Specifically for startups, there are several consulting firms or businesses out there in China already who do just that. There's one, I forget the name right now, but all they do is they help you make your prototype. They focus on your prototype and iterations of it until you are ready, and then they can introduce you for mass manufacturing or you can find on your own, but they help you in doing that, right? We have a bunch of hardware co-working spaces across China. We ourselves have a hardware accelerator in Shenzhen called Hacks, for instance. So if yours is a hardware startup, and if they think it's an interesting thing, they might invest in it and you can be part of Hacks. And you can build your product empty from there.
Want just to outsource the production, you can use the bulk cost.
So make visits to Shenzhen. Go to any of the major, you know, manufacturing conferences and all you have there. And you literally have to just go around and meet these manufacturers, see what they do. So you have to kind of know.
So you have to have your personal journey. You can't just outsource. You have to go deep into the country.
I think if you care enough about what you're doing, then you're going to have to go there yourself. Especially if you're a startup and you're building something that's that critical for your business. I think then you have to physically go yourself, no matter where you're outsourcing. You know, is this a critical part of your business? Then you got to go yourself. What you can is you can use these consulting companies or these advisors or your network to identify
preliminary stage.
Exactly. You can make a short list. You can communicate with them offline to sort of find out what they've done in the past, find out who their previous customers are, call up the customer, ask their experience, you know, do all this kind of due diligence. And then make your short list, but then I think you have to personally kind of go there and see the facility. Mm-hmm. Meet the team, you know, let them see how they talk about it, which also means you kind of have to be a bit of an expert yourself or know somebody who's an expert to take along to help you evaluate. Please understand that, you know, no matter what you think about Chinese manufacturing, China manufactures everything. If you're willing to pay the price, you can get the best stuff, but you don't want to pay the price. You want the absolute best manufacturing. That's always going to be a difficult bargain. Now even more so with the cost going up.
And again, talking about Chinaccelerator.
Mm-hmm.
So the startup which comes to Chinaccelerator, it will immediately gets also some investments. Investments, so you know, like
yeah, I mean, we as an accelerator, we do invest in the startups, and there's something at least $50,000 for 7%, 8% equity, and so on. This keeps changing, and it's also customized based on the startup. Mm-hmm. But yeah, they get the cash mm-hmm. very quickly.
So you propose co-working space as well? No?
We have our own office space, and all the teams are there. We've actually expanded it because we're taking more teams. So we have our own space, and the startups not only stay there for the 3 months, mm-hmm. they're allowed to stay there for the next 3 months.
Okay.
Right? Before we bring our next batch, they're allowed to stay there. So it's, we make transition as painless as possible. Because mm-hmm. after the 3 months, we have a demo day mm-hmm. when we invite hundreds of investors, and that's the idea, and that's where we have to take you to the point where you can get institutional investment. You can get some more angel investment. So maybe you're still doing a seed round or a pre-A. In some cases, you're doing an A round. So that's where we take the companies. And then Chinaccelerator also does follow-on investing in those startups. And so we try and make it as easy as possible, not make you, you're going everywhere for funding, plus you have to move office at the same time and all that. No.
So, for example, if the startup gets to the Chinaccelerator, immediately Chinaccelerator takes like 15%?
No, 7.
7?
Yeah.
So 7% of the equity.
Yeah.
And also provides additionally 50,000.
7% of the equity, you get cash, all the space, and you have the entire network, and plus, you know, over $500,000 worth of benefits.
Do you propose housing, you know, like for...
We actually have some rooms that we have accessible that are super cheap.
Okay.
And for some of the teams that come, they stay there.
Wonderful. So
the idea is to make it as simple so you can focus all your time and energy on building the business, building your app, building your product, whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And all the team is there, so all five or maybe down three people they
well,
have to be there.
It doesn't have to be everybody,
mm-hmm.
but I would say at least one co-founder,
uh-huh.
At least someone technical,
mm-hmm.
if that's what we're building.
Mm-hmm.
So CTO possibly should be there,
mm-hmm.
and then based on the business you can decide.
Okay. So
most teams come in with at least 3-4 people. And then usually in the 3 months they've grown from 3-4 to like 6-8. Yeah, because hopefully you're getting some traction
mm-hmm.
and you have to grow the team.
Very true.
So most of the startups will have an offshore company where we would invest in. So this could be the US or it could be in Hong Kong. It depends. I think for that it's something that the legal team at SOS looks at. But if I remember correctly, in most cases, as far as I recall, there is some offshore entity. Most startup investment in China from foreign money, from foreign currency investment, is actually put in offshore entities. So mostly Hong Kong, for instance. Because then it's easier in terms of getting all the investors in, the currency risk is taken care of, and then it's easier to list an offshore entity abroad than it is to do for a domestic entity.
Mm-hmm.
So after that, of course, you might end up having to set up 100% local subsidiary in China.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you take Shanghai and surrounding big cities with, what was it? Somebody was telling me it's like if you take a 2 or 3 hour train ride around Shanghai, you've got the entire EU population. And people talk about, ooh, I want to penetrate China. Right? Can you penetrate EU first? That complexity still remains. So what I'm saying is sitting here, you can think of ideas and models which might be very valid. And there's a lot of online literature available to read, consulting company reports, market analysis, consumer reports. So WeChat, if you Google online, you can find WeChat consumer reports, how consumers use WeChat, how they engage with it. That's a very good representation of the consumer market in many ways, right? So you can get a lot of the data, and then you can build hypotheses on the data. But the only way to check it is to actually be there or have somebody there do it for you. And I keep coming back to a central theme when I talk about China or even India. These are not markets that you can engage remotely. Mm-hmm. It just doesn't work. Unless you're already a mature business, right? You're an Uber or you're an Airbnb, and then you've got all these markets and now you're opening something in India or in China, got it. But even them, they have hardcore local teams. Uber, for instance, is a completely local company in China, right? And that's a lot to do with regulations as well, plus the need of the business and so on. So I fundamentally, after living for 14 years in China, I fundamentally believe if you are of any desire to engage in China and engage with that market, yes, you can have people there, you can get friends, or you just have to be there yourself, unless you really trust your friend in China to help you. Otherwise, you are not committed enough to tackle and handle the complexities of the market. Why many foreign companies don't succeed in China?
Too large.
They're just not, they didn't come with a commitment to the market. See, I'm trying to engage further and further with Ukraine. I think I think I'm more bullish about the future of your country and the opportunities that one can get engaging with Ukraine than most local people maybe. But that means because of that view, I'm coming here, I'm, you know, 8-9 times in 2.5 years. I'm still trying to learn, I'm still trying to understand, meet as many people and so on. I'm investing in my engagement. And I'm not making any conclusions even today. I'm still trying to figure it out. Do you understand what I mean? I mean, I might just be dumb and slow, so that's why it's taking me that long. But that's how I look at it. In China, you have the same kind of scenario, right? You've got to engage and you've got to look at the local customer. See, if I'm an international tech company, if I'm a Google, for instance, and I just show up in China and I have this website with a single window, search window, that doesn't appeal to Chinese taste. Have you ever seen a Chinese website? Just open any Chinese website. It's like full of information, right? And it's just nuts. Even if you actually track how the eyeball moves, so that's been done on Western websites and on Chinese websites, the eyeball focuses on different parts of the screen, right? And a lot of that is very, very sort of local. It's culture, it's also part of the language, because every character, every Chinese character is not just a sound, it means something. Each character has a unique meaning behind it, right? Or can be multiple meanings, in fact, right? So the way you engage with that, the way that language works, is very different in terms of how you even structure basic websites. Now, you can't just take the one-size-fit-all formula and try to force it thinking, oh, you know, poor country people, they don't know how to do things. They'll just take whatever we give them. I think many foreign companies have made the massive mistake of coming into China thinking that their existing models are the best, that they know what to do. We know, we are the experts, we're global leaders, don't worry. You know, who are these guys? They don't understand. And then China turned around and wonderfully gave them a nice kick in their ass. Right? And then built absolutely world-class companies domestically that are now going global and taking market share away from global companies. Do you see what I'm saying? So I think a bit of arrogance is one. Second is not a full commitment in terms of understanding the local market and then developing something for the market. It's kind of like this. Imagine you came up with a great product in your head and you built a company out of it, and then you come to it for investment and you say, I got this great product. I'm like, yeah, that's great, that's wonderful. Where's the market? Oh, I'm sure somebody will buy this, right? No, what's the first thing you should do? The first thing you should do is find a problem. You find a problem and then you make a solution for that problem. Now you tell me as an investor, this is the problem that I'm attacking, and this is how I'm going to solve the problem, and this is why I'm the best. Not here, I've got this fantastic cup, now let's go find markets for it. Who the fuck wants this cup? You understand? And that's part of the issue. So a lot of the foreign companies just came in, I've got this great cup, it's fantastic everywhere in the world. Yeah, but do Chinese use this kind of cup? Does it even fit their food? Does it fit their eating style? Have you even thought about that? No, but it's a world leader, man. You know, we're awesome. Doesn't work that way, right? Today, I'll give you an example. Say in automobile industry, for example, a lot of cars are now being for Chinese tastes, Chinese requirements. And if you look at most of these cars that are sold in China, they have long wheelbases. Why are they long? Because most Chinese have drivers. Even in the US, you own a Rolls Royce, you'll see celebrities driving their own Rolls Royce and going to events and whatever it is. In China, if you have a Rolls Royce, no fucking way you're driving it. You've got a driver for it, right? Even if you have like a medium-sized car, you've got a driver for it, right? Now, something as simple as that, right, changes how you look at the your product market fit.
So Chinese market is more arrogant and not tolerant to the foreigners.
No. That's not my point. we as foreigners earlier on were more arrogant when entering the market.
Yeah, that's true.
In terms of
what about Chinese? And for example, as I know that some, you know, like our colleagues from the Palm, we have an office in Shenzhen, for
mm-hmm.
example,
mm-hmm.
and they also, you know, like were sharing experience how it is to be in Shenzhen, for example.
Mm-hmm.
And there are some regions where no one speaks any English,
mm-hmm.
and there are some, you know, like more touristic,
mm-hmm.
so to say.
Mm-hmm.
And first, you know, like when you do not speak, you know, like Chinese, they treat you a little bit, you know, like if real foreigner. With the fear, you know, like who you are, what you want,
okay.
Something like this. Well, at least
I don't think so anymore. I mean, so many foreigners. You know, China's engagement. I mean, think about the Beijing Olympics in 2008. Think about the World Expo in Shanghai in 2010. I mean, if that's not engaging with the world, I don't know what is.
Okay.
You know. So many people have come just for manufacturing in China, right? It's been the manufacturing hub of the world. So I don't have the exact numbers of how many foreigners have visited China over the last 20 years, but exactly. So I don't think there's a fear of foreigners or a negative attitude towards foreigners. On the contrary, I think Chinese are very open to foreigners and outsiders. They're very friendly, to be very honest. I've never faced any sort of like open, blatant racism or negative attitude because I'm a foreigner. Never, ever.
So they are welcoming and
extremely welcoming, I think. And so, and I've faced that in many other places,
mm-hmm.
right? Even in my own country, in certain times and environments. So, I think it's a very I don't fully agree with that. What I do agree with, if you talk about IT and IT outsourcing companies, then most of the IT outsourcing companies in China, the foreign ones, are no bigger than a few thousand people.
True.
Even if I look at the Indian ones, for instance, I think the largest one, I might be wrong with the numbers right now, but it's definitely less than 5,000, more like 3,500. And these are companies that globally have 150,000, you know, workforce. 170,000, whatever it is, right? But in China, even after 12 years, they're only 3,500, 4,000. So if the largest, most well-known, respected IT outsourcing companies in the world still have just that small a size, I think for other companies, there's something to learn from it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, what's the strategy? Why did you go, why did EPAM or anybody else go to China? Are you following your customer? Are you trying to break into the local market? That's almost impossible. All the IT outsourcing companies, most of them, I would say, have had this problem of breaking into local business. What they're working more is with MNCs or with their existing customers who have operations in China, and they want you to help them out there, right?
Yeah. Oh, or just to buy already existing company who is doing, you know, like...
As a market entry strategy?
Yes.
Just think about this, right? Okay, I don't know EPAM's strategy or how they did it, so I'm not, that's not my comment, but I'm just thinking out loud. So I don't know Ukraine. I just know Ukraine is this big market or whatever, and I come here and I buy a Ukrainian company.
That's what EPAM did.
Yeah, so how easy would it, how easy would it be for me to run a Ukrainian company?
Then you even hire the CEO of this company to be your like...
No, okay, alternatives... My point is alternatives can be different, but just think about it. If I were to come tomorrow and buy a Ukrainian company without actually understanding how to work with you guys, even though you speak English, now it's supposed to be easier. Mm-hmm. How easy would it be for me to manage my team, to drive them towards whatever the terms are, excellence and performance and so on? How easy would it be for me as an Indian to do that? I think it'll be really fucking difficult.
Yeah.
If I don't understand your culture, I don't understand what motivates them, I don't understand the ecosystem, if I don't understand any of that and I just come for acquisition as a market entry strategy, even in Ukraine, I think it'll be very challenging unless I am a strong company that can afford this risk, A. B, I already have a lot of M&A experience, and you know, M&A is not just about buying the company, it's actually the real risk of M&A is post-merger integration. You buy the company, then how do you integrate it to your systems and your culture?
Yeah.
If you think it's tough for me to do that in Ukraine, then you can imagine how tough it is for anybody to do that in China.
True, as well.
Do you see what I'm saying? So
yeah.
That's what I'm saying. I don't know if that's a excellent strategy in the first place.
But from another side, it is possible to have some contracts with the company to feel, you know, like
that's
how you work with the team, which is already
that's
in
one
China,
way.
And then to buy them.
That's a different thing. That's a different thing. The biggest opportunities, I think, right now, in my view, exist in Asia. But then I'm biased. I'm living there. I'm seeing it. So I see China and India as the two biggest opportunities right now in terms of scale.
Okay.
But then that means there's a challenge because most Ukrainians don't have an understanding of Asia.
Yeah.
It's very, very, very poorly understood. So that has to be done first by the entrepreneur.
Second.
Wait. In terms of, you know, cultural fit and understanding, probably Europe, Western Europe is much closer in terms of your understanding. So, if you're not willing to, or for whatever reason, you have a significant market potential in Europe, Western Europe, then fine. There are significant, you know, entrepreneurial ecosystems in Western Europe, right? I'm not the expert on those, but I just came from a conference in Vienna, and there's a significant ecosystem in Vienna. There's one in Berlin, for instance, London as well. Paris also has a significant ecosystem. So there are various places that you can go to tap into the European market. There's good funding available, et cetera, et cetera. Or obviously everybody's favorite, the US, if that's, you know. But then that all depends on what problem are you trying to solve.
Yeah, where is your audience, market audience?
Yeah, what's the problem you're trying to solve and where is the market audience? Yeah.
Thank you. You talked about Bitcoin. And
yeah.
What is the future of Bitcoin? Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think the real essence of the technology is in the blockchain, right?
Uh-huh.
And the security that provides, and so on, and the records, and so on. So, I think the blockchain technology is fantastic. I think Bitcoin is one experiment on that. I'm not so sure that Bitcoin is going to die. I think it's going to keep, you know, surprising us, and it's going to, you know, there are dedicated developers who are taking it in one direction now. So the scare that we had in Bitcoin from that open letter with one of the main developers on it, what was his name, David Hearn, was it? I forget the name, maybe I got the name wrong. I think those are the kind of hiccups that we will find in any such new technology or usage of it. So I'm still holding bitcoins. I'm still playing with it. I don't have enormous bitcoin holdings, but you know, I'm fairly bullish on it still. I am. But I think we'll have a lot more interesting things, and a lot of things are happening right now using the blockchain. And that's, and if you look at fintech startups, a lot of them are doing it. We have another one also that's using the same technology for money transfers, for instance, called BitNexo, and so on. So that's, you know, my basic view.
Banks are also moving to blockchain.
They, yeah, you know, yeah. The blockchain provides some very interesting.
Building their software.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So that provides some very interesting plays. I still think, I mean, I'm bullish on Ukraine, first of all. That's why I'm here and I keep coming here. So I'm very positive about the future. And I think you have a lot of strengths to build on. You know, you're a very solid bridge between, you know, Asia and the East with Western Europe and even into the US. I think you have very strong engineering DNA. And not just, I mean, IT, you know, software engineering, but you come from a nation that was very strong in manufacturing, right? Somewhere along the line, that manufacturing expertise or those factories have been kind of lost, but you're still doing a lot of high-end manufacturing, especially in defense products and so on and so forth. So you have the DNA, you have the engineering capability. It's about marshaling resources around those strengths, first of all. And second is about not waiting for the government to be perfect. If and when it will be, it will be. I don't understand the politics. I have no comments on that. But I'm coming only from an Indian perspective. You know, if we wait for the government to be perfect, we would still be an underdeveloped country coming in amongst the poorest countries in the world and all this kind of stuff. Government is good at certain things, and at least in our case, they've done certain things very well. But in terms of, you know, development of industry, economy, and so on, a lot of it has to go, credit has to go to private entrepreneurs and businesses, people who set up their own thing and build from there, right?
And what do you think about Ukraine? So what is the capacity, what is the best scenario from your point of view? Outsourcing products?
Ask how you want.
Or to keep, you know, like engineering DNA and, you know, like to think about these kind of things. Because you have experience, you know different countries.
That's a question that people far more capable and much, much better than me are trying to answer. So I'm not sure if I have a great answer or anything revolutionary, so to say. But I think, you know, a few elements that would go a long way is one, some sort of updating of the education system, mm-hmm. first. Mm-hmm. You can't rest on talent that has already been produced with an older education system that is becoming less and less relevant, not only in Ukraine, but globally. Mm-hmm. Right? So I think one advantage is if you're making changes, one core area to update is the education system. That's the long-term future, first of all. Mm-hmm. So update that, modernize that, the topics and the kind of skills that you're training for should not be for today's economy, but they should be for the next 10, 15, 20, 100 year economy, right? That's one very huge step that I think can be taken. And then built on that, so you have the human resource on one side, you still have the manufacturing DNA on the other side. So then it's either a matter of, you know, coming up with finding the right kind of global problems that you can address, create the service businesses for that or create the manufacturing business for that, and then target global markets, mm-hmm. right? As opposed to just the domestic market. Mm-hmm. Right? And from there, again, that opens up a whole lot of questions as well, but, you know, step by step, I think that can be eventually figured out. I don't think I have the ability right now to tell you which industry to go for or anything like that. But again, where I come from, my bias view is always startups and entrepreneurs, and giving them the tools and access to find the problems and find the solutions themselves. Give them that ecosystem to leverage. That's it.
Yeah, thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you.